Hi, I'm Anna, an Earth Sciences PhD student at the University of Oxford. I'm interested in volcanoes and why sometimes they erupt with a really big explosion, but sometimes with a smaller and much less dangerous one. One thing we think is really important in figuring out how explosive an eruption will be is the amount of pressure that builds up beneath a volcano. If we can understand a bit more about these levels of pressure and how they might change, this can help us to understand the scale and type of the next eruption. The island of Montserrat in the Caribbean is a tropical paradise, but in 1995, the Suffrage Hills volcano on the island started to erupt. This eruption destroyed the capital city of Plymouth and forced two-thirds of the island's residents to flee. Most of the destruction was caused by short-lived volcanic explosions and pyroclastic flows. These are super hot mixtures of volcanic gas and rock that can travel at speeds up to hundreds of kilometers an hour. But between these bouts of epic destruction, the volcano goes through much quieter phases, slowly pushing out lava into a dome at the surface, or just pumping out gas through cracks in the summit. Deep within the Earth's crust is a liquid we call magma. This magma is what we eventually see erupted at the surface as lava. Within this magma, there are different amounts of mineral crystals, like quartz, and also bubbles of gases, such as carbon dioxide and water. Let's keep things simple and imagine that all of this magma is stored within one big magma chamber, or reservoir. Sometimes the pressure within this reservoir increases, and so the magma pushes outwards on the rock surrounding it. If the pressure of the magma is too great, then the crustal rocks around it can fail and break, and then the magma rushes to the surface in an explosive eruption, just like what happened in the 1980 eruption of Mount St. Helens in the United States of America. At a volcano like Suffrage Hills on Montserrat, even after the magma has found a pathway to the surface, the pressure within that magma reservoir can still vary depending on how much new magma arrives from deeper in the crust. Sometimes the pressure in the magma reservoir is balanced out by the pressure exerted by the column of magma above it, and then in these cases, the volcano is quiet and relatively safe. But with little warning, these pressures can get out of balance and the volcano can explode, sometimes with fatal consequences. At different depths within the volcanic system, the magma is under different amounts of pressure. We can estimate these pressures using the equation pressure equals height times density times gravity. So in our example, the pressure within the magma reservoir is equal to the height of the magma column above it, multiplied by the density of the partially liquid magma, multiplied by the force of gravity. This is just like you working out how much pressure you experience when you dive to the bottom of a swimming pool. Magmas and the crystals and bubbles within them behave differently at the different pressures and temperatures beneath a volcano. For my PhD project, I use this equipment to do experiments to work out how the crystals within magma change as they rise from deep within the Earth's crust up to the Earth's surface. Here is some volcanic rock called pumice, which erupted from the Suffrage Hills volcano on Montserrat. I grind up this rock, put it into these capsules, and load them into these pressure vessels. Then I turn this valve to create high pressures, which forces water through these little pipes and onto a really small area in contact with my capsule of rock. As pressure equals force divided by area, this is a really efficient way to focus the force of the water and increase the pressure on my rock sample. As well as applying high pressures, these furnaces also heat the rock up to hundreds of degrees Celsius, just like real magma. Once my experiment is finished, I cool and depressurize the system and take out my rock. Now it's no longer a fine powder, but a fragment of glass, bubbles, and crystals. So now I can look at the shapes and numbers of the crystals and bubbles within this sample to tell me more about how the magma will move beneath the volcano. Hopefully, one day, this will help us to make better predictions about when a volcano is next likely to erupt, helping to save lives.